Hello, everybody. This is Toni Turner, and welcome to the market now as of Friday, February 23rd, right after the markets close. Well, a gauge of global equity markets lost steam on today after setting a new intraday high as optimism over NVIDIA's results softened while the dollar index was steady as Federal Reserve officials indicated rate cuts will come later than expected. Wall Street's main indexes shot up to new highs at the open today as NVIDIA climbed above $2 trillion in market value for the first time, driven by the AI frenzy that has gripped markets since the chipmaker's blockbuster quarterly report 2 days ago. So on that note, let's go on to three charts that will give us some insight into the week to come. First of all, we're going to look at a daily chart of the S&P 500 Spider, symbol SPY. As you all know, this is the exchange-traded fund that closely follows our benchmark S&P 500 index. Now, the SPY, you can't see it on this chart because of the way it's made. Anyway, I will tell you. The SPY closed today at $507 right here, $507.25. Now, that wasn't the real high. The SPY reached an intraday high today at $510.13. But again, we closed $3 lower at $507.25. Now, as you all know, we've looked at quite a few times. We've had a fantastic uptrend since the October lows right here. The SPY had been moving in kind of a downtrend until the October lows of 2022. At that point, interest rates started to roll a bit lower, and of course, low interest rates make the market happy. So right down here in October, when the SPY hit about 409, buyers started coming in, the shorts started covering. And since then, the SPY has made higher lows, in definition of an uptrend, higher lows and higher highs in a strong uptrend that once it got started here, it flew right through the 200-day moving average, through the 20-day moving average, the red line through the green line, the 50-day moving average, and traded at quite a premium here to the 20-day moving average. Until it shot up kind of almost straight, not quite vertical, but close to it. Then consolidated for a little while in November because nothing goes straight up forever. Kind of moved back into a couch using the 20-day moving average as a couch or a staircase, as we call it. And then price continued, the SPY continued to move up, higher lows, higher highs. Now, in January, it did slide down here a couple of times below the 20-day moving average, but only stayed below it for 2 days, closed below it, that's the important part of the day, closed below it very, very briefly for 2 days, and then very, very briefly for this 1 day, and fell down here to about 467. But it popped right back up, and then we had earnings season start. So then the SPY got a lot more energy as earnings season brought in more buyers up, making a higher high, using the 20-day as a staircase or as the stairs or the sofa, whatever you want to call it, moved up again, fell back. It's getting out of breath now. You can see how the pace is changing here a bit, but still strong. And then gapped up until we had today's close at 507.25. And right here, of course, was the gap up on this week on NVIDIA's earnings. So from the October lows to the highs today, the SPY has had a 24% gain, which is a very, very nice one. Now, the 14-day RSI we look at, that's locked up above 70 again, saying, of course, that we're overbought in the short term. It's going to be interesting to see how the SPY acts in the coming week, whether from here it needs to drop back down to its 20-day moving average to get some support, The 20-day is coming in right now at $496.23. What I did today, except for this big move up down here at the very beginning or toward the beginning of this uptrend, today I was kind of counting the premium that the SPY can move, or the distance we'll call it, that it can fly over the 20-day moving average. And I sort of averaged these out and noticed that so far it's had the strength to climb from about 2 to 3% up over the 20-day moving average before it has to come down and get its footing again on top of that trend, of that line, which has acted as a trend line. So right at the moment, the SPY is trading at about 2.5% above the 20-day moving average, which is kind of the average of all these recent ones. So that's just something to talk about at the cocktail hour. I am bullish in the long term, but I am tightening my stops on short-term trades right now. This is all wonderful, but I want to keep my profits. Our next chart today is a chart of the Invesco QQQ, symbol QQQ. Of course, the Qs represent the NASDAQ 100, the top 100 non-financial companies by market capitalization in the NASDAQ, including quite a few of the much talked about Magnificent Seven companies recently, which include NVIDIA, Meta, Amazon, Microsoft, that whole group. Now, the Qs closed today, as you can see here, at $436.78. It actually made an all-time high today. It wasn't the closing high. The closing high was what we just said, $436.78. But it made an all-time high. It touched an all-time high today at $440.59. Just wanted you to know. Since the Qs rallied out of the October low, that low was at 342, of course, same reason the SPY did, reversed and broke above. Now, it did not go, the Qs didn't go below its 200-day moving average during that time in October 2023. It did not go below the 200-day moving average, but it shot up nicely through the 20-day moving average, through the 50-day moving average, jumped way up above both the 20 and 50. Right here, you see that bullish cross right here of the 20 moving over the 50. So then it gapped up on November 14th to open at $383.71. Then started using the 20-day moving average as its trend line. You can say it lost its breath and slipped lower in the first week of January down to 395, then rallied, dipped, and rallied again. And then in February of 21, which was actually this week, it gapped down to $421.63. But then everybody knew NVIDIA's earnings were coming out, and a lot of people bought into that idea or that what was going to happen. And as you can see, then we moved up the last 2 days again to be where we're closed today on Friday at $436.78. From the October lows, this uptrend that the Qs have climbed into, if you bought at the very low and still owned it right now, and probably nobody in the world buys at the lows and sells at the highs, but if you did, the Qs is up just about 28%. So that's a very, very nice uptrend. Nearby price support here, should the Qs get tired next week, is at the 20-day moving average, again at $429.64. We have the pivot down here at 425, this pivot low at 425 and 421, and the 50-day moving average here at 417.21, so call it 417. So there is some nearby support here should the Qs decide they need it. It will be an interesting week next week, so please, again, pay attention to your protective stops. Our final chart today, every ETF, literally, except ones that I didn't want, were trading in extreme overbought zones today. So I went to one that I've been watching here for the past couple of weeks. This is the VanEck Gold Miners ETF, symbol GDX. It has 57 holdings, including Newmont Corporation, Barrick Gold, Agnico Eagle, Franco-Nevada, and Wheaton Precious Metals as some of their top holdings. Now, again, most sector ETFs and industry group ETFs that I've looked at today are overbought, at least in the short term. So I'm going to a place that maybe might be an idea to hold a few shares of this if it stays above our stop, just in the short term. I've heard a lot going on about inflation rising again and so forth. So anyway, I just thought I would look at this. And I do like the chart pattern as long as it holds where I want it to. So the GDX closed today at, as you can see, at $26.66. Now, it fell to October lows too, but gold miners don't usually follow the stock market. So it had its lows much earlier in October than I'm going to say most of the other sectors did. The GDX fell to October lows here in 2023 at $25.62. Then it rallied straight up. That's a nice ride. To meet with September resistance from earlier, you see the September resistance and even very close to the October, the August resistance. So it rallied up here to meet up with September resistance right around $30, but it couldn't break out. And then because it couldn't, I guess it fell back down here and fell in November to 27, then shot higher. It's been quite a ride. Up to $31.91 on December 1st. Didn't hold that and fell back again to about 29 in mid-December, fell down to the 50-day moving average, and it held there. Then rallied to make a higher high on December 22nd at $32.35. Then, again, it's been quite a ride, then fell down to February lows right down here at $25 and down here to $25.68. And since then, it's held, see, the October low is back here. So the recent fall here has been back down to almost exactly those October lows. Then it rallied back up here this past, well, we'll call it almost 2 weeks of trading, then fell back down, is holding now at lows of about 26, okay? 25, 60, 26 right here. So I'm looking at this and thinking that maybe I want, if it behaves and if it stays where I want it to and starts higher, maybe this would be kind of a nice small hedge to have in the market. So if in the coming week the GDF holds above these support lows, I'm going to call it above $25.60, okay, to give it some. So if it holds above $25.60, the GDX, I will add a small position to my trading portfolio, and I'm going to put in a firm stop at $25. It's just all right where this red line, a firm stop, because for some reason it doesn't go where I want it to. I'm not certainly going to have any emotion about it. But my firm stop is at $25. If and when it climbs above $29, which is up here at this recent pivot high, if and when it climbs above $29 and stays above it for three consecutive trading days, I will add to my position and trail my stop. Of course, by then I will be. So you may want to keep an eye on the GDX in the coming week. And now, if you'd like to become a more successful trader, this is a great time to check out my online training programs. You can choose from 10 different programs, including our flagship product, 7 Steps to Successful Trading. Everybody likes that. You can also learn how to swing trade with How to Swing Trade Successfully, very, very popular program. Trade the Trend to Profits. How to Read Charts, great for newcomers. 3 Winning Setups, great for short-term traders. And hey, maybe with, who knows, maybe with our GDX, we can bottom fish like a pro. I love that that program. So if you'd like to learn how to do any of these strategies, these programs will show you how to elevate your trading skill set and how you can increase your gains quickly and easily. Check out all of my online training courses by going to the link on this screen up here, or easier still, just click on the orange button below. Until next week, be careful out there. Keep green on your screen. I'm Toni Turner, and this is The Market Now.